I'm Susan Calman, and this is Secret Scotland.
I'm back, continuing my quest to uncover the nation's hidden treasures. Scotland is vast. At over 30,000 square miles, it's nearly 40% of the whole of Great Britain.
Stunning.
My journeys around my homeland have already revealed some amazing secrets, but this time there's even more to discover. Things I've never seen.
Magic.
And things I've never done.
There we go. Yeah.
Visiting its highlands.
I just beat a world champion.
And its islands. Its coast.
I went in too deep.
And its crags.
Look at it.
I'm opening the door to world-class wonders.
Oh, come on now.
I'll be hands-on.
My goodness.
As I get a taste of Scotland's history.
Hello.
From deep caves to towering castles.
It is probably time for a Queen of Scotland.
It's an exclusive tour of some amazing places.
It's your very own Secret Scotland.
My amazing journey is bringing me home to Glasgow. Experiencing it like never before.
I have never seen the city like this.
Getting a taste of the culture.
It just keeps getting better.
And to cap it off, making some new friends.
Watching a cow's tail.
You might think I know everything about the place because I've lived here my whole life, but I think we're going to find something quite unexpected.
To truly get to know Glasgow, you need to know the River Clyde. So I've dumped the car and headed down the water to experience it full throttle.
I'm James Bond! A very frightened James Bond!
There's an old saying around these parts that Glasgow made the Clyde and the Clyde made Glasgow. Shipbuilding has been taking place on the river in one shape or form since the 15th century. And at its peak in the 1900s, it was said that a fifth of all ships worldwide were built here.
But you can still feel the history of the shipbuilding in this area. That was unbelievable.
I don't think I've seen Glasgow in a better light. This is the best view of Glasgow you're going to get on a speedboat down the Clyde.
The ancient settlement that became Glasgow was founded to the east of the current city centre. High on a hilltop less than a mile from the river is the heart of old Glasgow and a place I've visited many times. Glasgow Cathedral. The cathedral was built in 1136 above the tomb of St Mungo, the patron saint and founder of Glasgow.
Absolute pleasure to see you.
And to help me uncover the secrets of this magnificent building is cathedral guide Ian Lowe.
It's a stunning place, this. Would I be right in saying that this is where the city of Glasgow was first started?
Yes, this is the oldest building in Glasgow.
But I imagine when it first started, the cathedral didn't look like this.
No, absolutely.
No, because this would be quite a thing to have built in those days.
But it almost wasn't here at all. The 16th century Protestant reformers, in their zeal, all but destroyed countless churches, icons and effigies across Scotland. But remarkably, Glasgow Cathedral came through it.
The tradespeople are significant in the story of what was known as the Dinging Doon of the cathedral.
The Dinging Doon.
Yes. Glasgow Cathedral was the only mainland church to survive the Reformation with its roof intact. Mm-hmm. Many of the churches were destroyed.
So during the Reformation, there was a destruction of churches?
Yes. Anything that was Catholic was to be wiped from Scotland.
Two decades later, in 1579, the cathedral came under attack again when local authorities tried to tear it down and replace it with three smaller churches. but they'd underestimated the cathedral's popularity.
On the day of the demolition, the tradespeople of Glasgow formed a line and said, "You will not knock our cathedral down." In fact, they said, "If the first man to remove a stone from it will be buried underneath it." So everybody believes the story because that was what Glasgow would do.
Of course it is. You're not dinging down our cathedral.
Exactly.
Oh, isn't that amazing? That is the kind of thing, though, that Glasgow would do.
Exactly.
It may have become a people's cathedral, but royalty also has a place here, a place most can't access.
Well, I love getting to go places no one else does. How exciting.
This is what's known as the Royal Pew. This one was made in 1954 for the present Queen Elizabeth, and nobody else has ever sat in it.
So nobody sits in this chair?
No. When Prince Charles came, he sat in his father's chair. Princess Anne came, she sat in the front pew.
Now, you know me, viewers. I always like to have a go at things, but I think in this instance, I have not got permission. I'm not going to sit in that chair. Look at Ian. Thank goodness, I thought she was going to try and sit in the chair. I think we should just leave it. Let's leave it.
Treason averted, I'm seeking out someone who can show me more of the fascinating craftsmanship of this building. And some of it takes a bit of effort to reach. Cathedral stonemason Johnny Clark is going to help me scale the heights.
I'm in safety gear, Johnny. What
yes.
are we doing?
We're going to go to the top of the cathedral.
It's quite high.
Very.
Good views.
Beautiful views.
Is that where we're going?
Yes.
OK, safety gear on. Danger Calman is in the house. Let's go. Go on, Johnny. Take me up. Take me up your staircase, Johnny. You need to help me up the step, Johnny. Thanks very much. That's a good start, isn't it?
What Johnny's really kept secret is how narrow and steep these stairs are. And there's 101 of them.
And I never thought I was afraid of heights, but I can tell you now, I've got a smartwatch and my heart rate's just gone up by 30 to about 90. And we're going even further, aren't we, Johnny? Feeling great. Let's keep going, Johnny.
And it's not just visiting royalty that get a privileged pew. Up here are the other best seats in the house, which would have given the city's dignitaries quite a view.
Wow. So where are we, Johnny?
This is, some folk know it as the Magistrates' Gallery. There's a bit of speculation of what it was actually, the purpose of it.
It's the ultimate VIP suite to avoid people seeing you in here, isn't it? What's quite stunning is, you come into the cathedral and you see it from down below. The faces of these sculptures, it's stunning, absolutely stunning. The detail up here, you can see how much work's gone into, how much craftsmanship's gone into each of these things. Uh-huh. It's beautiful.
But apparently the craftsmanship continues at the top of the cathedral, and getting there takes me past views of my hometown I've never seen before.
Essentially on the roof of Glasgow Cathedral, very few people get to come up here. I've got my safety harness on, so everything's fine. But from here, you can see virtually the whole city. And I can honestly say, I have never seen the city like this before. It is really, really incredible. Tell me about these wonderful, wonderful marks.
A mason's mark was just a simple design. It was just a series of lines, because when you go back to the 12th century, right through, they couldn't read or write.
So they left a symbol instead
a
of
symbol.
Their name. This fella here was on a tea break, wasn't he? Because yeah. everyone else has scratched into
exactly,
it.
Yeah.
And he's decided to give himself
Too
a very, very grand
time.
One.
Today, Johnny is doing restoration work, and he's going to teach me how to create my own mason's mark that's set to become a permanent part of Glasgow's oldest building.
This is kind of a strange cross between a CSI outfit and a Ghostbusters outfit. Why have you dressed me in such seductive wear?
Well, the paper suit is to protect you from the dust, and the Airstream helmet is a constant airflow.
Would you like to turn me on, Johnny? I can... What's going on? What have you attached to me? If I do an S, Susan, and because it's straight lines, I'll just do a C. So that's SC.
Okay.
So that'll be my mark. Is that okay?
That's your mark.
Here we go. Ready for it? Okay. Right, you can do this, Susan. You can do this. So, just put the chisel in.
Aye, position yourself.
Oh, it's like ghost. Do that again, Johnny. That was great.
Just need to position yourself.
Oh, my love, my darling. Right, so chisel in.
Chisel in. If you feel as if you're digging, and you're just tattooing it on. Perfect.
Oh, I love that. Uh-huh.
Well, there you go.
That's really great, isn't it?
Aye. So every time you get by that bit of the cathedral,
you'll know.
You'll know.
You and me,
that's
Johnny.
That's right.
Master stonemason.
An apprentice.
You can't tell the difference. That's how good I was. Do you know, I always hoped I'd leave some form of legacy in Glasgow. Maybe a giant statue of me astride the Clyde, something low-key, something like that. But this is even better, because do you know what? I have actually left my mark in Glasgow. And it's going to be just up there.
Coming up, the birthplace of one of Britain's favourite dishes.
There's 25 different ingredients in that.
And I fulfil a childhood ambition. I'm Susan Calman, and I'm finding secrets all over Scotland. This time, I'm taking a trip round my hometown of Glasgow, and I'm discovering things I've never known before. I'm heading to the south of the city to visit the spiritual home of Scottish football and Scotland's national stadium, Hampden Park. This is a very, very special place. I've had some of the best nights of my life here. Scotland versus Italy. Scotland scores against Italy. I hugged an Italian man. I don't know his name. I didn't need to know his name. It's no exaggeration to say that one of my dreams is to score a goal at Hampden Park. Hampden was opened in 1903 and instantly became the world's biggest football stadium. But Glasgow's international footballing history goes back even further. In 1872, the world's first official international football match was played between England and Scotland with a goalless draw. And surprisingly, the venue was the West of Scotland cricket ground. I know, cricket in Glasgow, who knew? I'm about to discover another Scottish sporting surprise. Despite Scotland's not always glowing World Cup success in the men's game, one Scottish woman reached the absolute pinnacle in international football.
I can't tell you how delighted I am to talk to you today because you, Rose, have an accolade that not a lot of people know about because you, Rose, you won the World Cup.
Yeah, I did, Susan. How cool is that?
It's more than a little bit cool, Rose. But interestingly, who did you win the World Cup for?
Italy.
Of course you did.
Italia.
Of course you did.
Yeah.
You're as Scottish as they come and you win for Italy. That's
what's wrong with that? The Scottish heart beating under an Italian jersey.
Of course there was. I'm just so excited because I never thought in my lifetime I would stand next to a World Cup winner. It really is.
Congratulations.
Thanks.
I'm here.
As a girl, the only way Rose Riley could play football was to cut her hair and pretend to be a boy. She joined a women's team, and it wasn't long before her hard work and talent paid off. She was spotted by scouts from Italian club AC Milan and was eventually approached by the Women's Football Federation.
The president of the whole federation asked me if I would play for Italy. I said, how are we going to manage that? He said, would you like to marry some old guy in a nursing home? I said, I'm not going as far as that.
I'm glad that was your line, Rose.
Not unless he's a millionaire.
That's exactly my answer.
After moving to Italy, Rose became an adopted Italian, making her eligible for the women's national side. 11 years later, in 1984, she was picked for her first international tournament, the forerunner to the Women's World Cup.
We beat West Germany in the final. I set up the first goal, scored the second goal, and kind of set up the penalty for the last goal.
So you scored in the World Cup final?
Yeah.
And you won, Italy
yeah.
won.
Rose Riley from Italia.
More recently, she was the first woman to be inducted into the Hall of Fame at Hampden and was capped for representing Scotland in a match against England in 1972. And you really do get a cap.
Can I try on your hat?
Your cap? Oh, my goodness, to be
capped. How'd you feel?
Oh,
look, how'd you feel?
Look, Rose, I'll be honest with you. To be capped for Scotland...
Aye.
I mean, not even... This is... I love Scotland. Uh-huh. And this is quite special.
Ah, it suits you. Congratulations.
Oh, thanks so much. Is this how easy it is? I played for Scotland. This is extraordinary.
And I simply can't come here without having a go. I'm about to have a dream come true. Walking out onto the hallowed turf.
People talk about the Hampden roar. I can hear it in my ears. There's no one here, but I can hear it.
There may not be an adoring crowd, but I am meeting three footballing talents from the under-19 Scotland squad. Amy, Sophie and Michaela are going to share some footballing secrets that might take them on to World Cup glory in the future.
So we're going to do a masterclass. You're going to get in goal. You two are going to show me how to do it, and then I'm going to triumphantly score a goal at Hampden, right? Because it's my dream.
What's the key to taking a good penalty?
When you're striking it, head over the ball so you keep it low.
Head over the ball. And as a goalkeeper, what will fox you when I'm taking a penalty?
Just like... I don't like when they just stare at you and, like, put you under pressure.
Okay, I won't do that. I'm so going to do that. There's quite a long run-up she's taking. Oh, that was a really good penalty. Oh, fingertip.
What she said was she doesn't like it when... She doesn't like it when people stare her down, so just watch this, right? Watch this.
It's Calman to take the penalty. This is it for Scotland.
Yeah!
Goal! Now, I suppose Sophie might have gone easy on me, but still, a goal's a goal!
She scores a goal at Hampden. No big deal. Just a dream come true.
Fresh from victory, my next stop is Glasgow's West End. And as any local knows, when you're getting around here, there are better ways to travel than by car.
One of the best ways to get from one place to another is to take the subway. It's brilliant.
Opened in 1896, Glasgow Underground is the third oldest subway in the world after London and Budapest. Affectionately known as the Clockwork Orange, it takes 24 minutes to complete a circuit of the 15 stations.
It just goes round and round. That's the point of the subway. I think it's the best fairground ride you're ever going to be on. Gets you from A to B, gives you a bit of a shake, and it's just... It's the sound of Glasgow, that's what that is. It's the sound of Glasgow.
And it's brought me to my next destination.
This looks like a lovely restaurant, doesn't it? Nothing special, though. You'd be wrong. Because not only is this the place where I had my very first curry at the age of 6 or 7, but it's also where they invented my favourite dish, the chicken tikka masala.
Opened in 1964 by Ahmed Aslam Ali, the Shish Mahal is now run by his son, Asif. I've got a table for two to find out how they developed a dish that went on to be voted Britain's favourite.
You have a very special story about why you think that this place was where it started.
My dad was saying it was a winter's night and the bus driver finished his shift and he sat down and asked for a chicken curry. In the meanwhile, Dad had an ulcer at that time. He couldn't take anything spicy, so he was having Campbell's tomato soup when the bus driver told him to take it back. It's too dry. And Dad says to the chef, put the soup in the curry, heat it up and give it back to him, you know. And he loved it. He absolutely loved it.
I just love that. Because it's like at home when you're having dinner and you think, what have I got in the cupboard? And you just mix lots of stuff together.
I could only say it's like alchemy, you know.
The recipe has, of course, been refined since then to the crowd pleaser that we know and love today.
Can you show me how you make your chicken tikka masala?
We can show you, but what we cannot show you is our secret sauce that we use in the chicken tikka masala.
What if I promised not to open my own restaurant in my house? Could I know then?
No.
Well, let's see if this kitchen really is confidential. Asif and I are joining head chef Hamayo for a masala masterclass.
Right. Okay. I don't know what this is. Oh! There's yogurt in that. Is that right?
I can't tell you. Because this is the secret sauce.
Oh, is that
sauce?
The secret sauce?
That's the secret sauce, yeah.
I can taste yogurt.
Well... There's 25 different ingredients in that.
25?
Yeah.
Well, I think I've got one of them, but instead of trying to crack the recipe, I might as well learn how to make it, and Asif is upping the stakes.
The inventor of the chicken tikka masala is here.
No.
Yeah, my dad.
OK, well, that's just up the pressure a bit. Right, you step back and let me cook.
On you go.
OK? Right, yeah. Let's do it.
First up, chopped onions.
Right, it's all in.
And then put some oil in it. When you put oil, it's going to be big flame.
Would you mind doing that for me then?
Yeah.
Wow, that's a big flame.
And then we are going to blend it.
Yeah?
So we change the...
So you blend that.
Uh-huh. And that came like this.
Once blended with paprika and garlic, it starts to feel more like a curry.
I cannot tell you the smell. This is my happy place. Oh, it just keeps getting better. It's like my birthday, right?
Yeah, okay.
Okay,
ready?
Yeah, ready? So that's the chicken tikka going in. It looks amazing. Look at the chicken tikka.
Peppers are added, and then a dash of cream.
And mix it.
Mix it. So this is what we're putting, secret sauce.
That's our secret sauce.
Right.
We are going to add into...
Oh, look at the colour of it! Look at the colour!
A final stir, and it's ready to serve to its inventor, Mr. Ali.
Mr. Ali, pleasure to meet you.
Welcome.
I've tried to recreate your invention. Can you dig in? Can you try some of that? This is the important bit. Good. Is it good?
Good. Very good.
Very good?
Delicious.
I think what we need to do now is probably I'll finish this and decide whether or not it's good or not.
Coming up, the oldest surviving music hall on Earth, where I learn about the Glaswegian audience.
If they liked you, they let you live.
And I confuse the phrase, taking the bull by the horns.
Washing a cow's tail!
We'd like to send you and a friend to Ayrshire in southwest Scotland to spend 2 5-star nights at Glenup Castle, sharing a grand sea view suite. You'll enjoy a full Scottish breakfast each morning and a 3-course dinner with wine on one evening. Plus, there's a chance to explore the ruggedly beautiful local scenery, heading one day on a private sea safari to nearby Ailsa Craig. You may even spot some iconic Scottish wildlife too. So for your chance to relax in this coastal corner of sublime Scotland, text SCOTLAND to 65555 or call 0902 055 0055 or post your name and phone number to Scotland, PO Box 7557, Derby, DE10NP. Text costs £2 plus one message at standard network rate. Calls cost £2 plus your network access charge. Lines close midday on the date shown on screen and 3 working days later for postal entries. For rules, go to channel5.com/win. Good luck! I'm Susan Calman, and I'm back on an epic adventure all over Scotland. This time, I'm taking a fresh look at my hometown. I'm heading east of the city centre to the Trongate area of Glasgow to discover a unique piece of theatrical history, the Panopticon Music Hall.
Back there is one of Glasgow's busiest streets, and you might think that's where the fun is, but you'd be wrong. Because if you take a turn down this unassuming alleyway, you'll find something truly magical.
To help me understand the significance of this building, I'm meeting Judith Bowers, who discovered it lying derelict back in 1991 and decided to bring it back to life.
Judith, this is, I think, one of the most special places in Glasgow, if not Scotland.
This amazing survivor is the world's oldest music hall.
So it is the world's?
It's the world's
not
oldest.
Scotland's, not the Scotland. UK's. No. The world's oldest music hall.
Back in its heyday, when it opened in 1857, it was filled with body acts and was taken over by the showman A.E. Pickard, who added a rooftop carnival and, unbelievably, a zoo in the basement.
The performers that were here were talented, though, weren't they?
Oh, my goodness, yeah, you had to be. I mean, they actually said of this music hall, if they liked you, they let you live. Mm-hmm. And they... I mean, we've got wonderful accounts about the boys who used to like to sit in the very front section of the balcony.
Just up there.
Just up mm-hmm. there. It meant they could urinate over the edge and try and hit the act on stage below.
Oh, I just love it.
And the boys at the back of the balcony threw horse manure. That was their favourite thing to grab, free of charge outside.
One person who narrowly managed to avoid such a reception was a young aspiring comedian called Stan Laurel.
And you would not think that Stan Laurel, the world's one of the world's most famous comedians, set foot on that stage, didn't he?
Yeah, he did. He debuted in here when he was 16.
Originally from Cumbria, Stan moved to Glasgow as a boy with his parents.
He used to skive off school and sneak into this music hall and watch all his favourite comedians. And then a month after his 16th birthday, he came in here and he said to Mr Pickard, "Can I perform?" And Mr Pickard said, "Why?" And Stan said, "'Cos I'm funny." And so Mr Pickard said, "I'll tell you what, son, you can have the Friday amateur slot if you like."
But his act came about by accident. In 1906, Stan skipped school and took to the stage. At the end of the act, his clumsy exit became comedy gold.
He actually went to get off the stage. He took the hat off to take a bow and fumbled it and dropped it and then stepped forward to retrieve it and kicked it into the orchestra. And then a lady from the orchestra tried to retrieve it, tripped over her dress and crushed it. The audience was in hysterics.
And I find it fascinating that through a mistake almost and fear in a Glasgow stage, one of the world's greatest comedians was born.
Absolutely.
It's a beautiful story, isn't it?
It's a fantastic story.
And as a special treat, Judith is screening one of Laurel and Hardy's early films just for me.
It's quite a strange feeling to be watching Stan Laurel on the screen just behind the stage where, as a 16-year-old, he started his comedy career. It's a really special thing, actually, because it's something that Glasgow should be very proud of, that we essentially created one of the world's greatest comedians. And we can still watch him today. When he first started.
This city slicker is ready to breathe in some fresh air. But you're in town, I hear you cry. True, however, Glasgow is also known as the Dear Green Place because, despite its industrial past, Glasgow has been described as having more green space per head of population than any other city in Europe. So I'm heading south of the city for some fresh air.
Whenever anyone visits Glasgow and they say to me, "Where should I go, Susan?" I say one thing, go to Pollock Park and see the Highland Cows, because they are an attraction not to be missed.
These iconic beasties have been here since 1826, and this herd are direct descendants of the original cattle. In charge, and with possibly the best job in Glasgow, are Melissa Sinclair and herdsman Matt Auld. And believe it or not, as a Glasgow resident, these cows belong to me.
They were gifted to the people of Glasgow from the owners of Pollock House, the Stirling Maxwells, and they donated them to the people of Glasgow.
So these are the people of Glasgow's cows?
You're very fortunate that young calf, his mum, is called Susan. Was that a coincidence?
No, was that specifically for me, Matt?
No. We have a family of Susans because every daughter is named after its mum. We have Susans forevermore.
So, forevermore in Pollock Park, there'll probably be a Susan cow.
Yes.
Lovely.
In each field, there'll be a Susan.
I don't mind that. They're lovely.
Well, I think it's only polite to say hello to my namesake.
Hi. Do we look alike, do you think, Matt?
Well, same colour of kind of jumper,
oh,
maybe.
Oh, Susan. Oh, she's away. Susan did not enjoy having her side touched, which, as you know, just for information, neither do I. So if you see me, don't tickle my side either, because that's what's going to happen to you.
These cows are also award winners, regularly bagging prizes at the biggest event in the cow calendar, the Royal Highland Show. Today, Matt and Melissa are getting them ready for the 2019 show.
What do you do for the cows so that they're tippity-top for the shows?
I think what we should really do is get Susan to do it for us, because I'm sure she's quite capable of washing, blow-drying, sandpapering the horns and putting on the various sprays that we use.
Hold on a second, Matt. So I'm about to go and be a beautician for a Highland cow?
Yes.
Well, I tell you something, when I woke up this morning, that was not what I was expecting to be doing.
Well, since I am part owner, I guess it's only right I should do my bit.
What I would do is I would stand here, get close as you can.
This is a shampoo and set.
This is the shampoo that I've got to hide.
Right.
Because, and don't tell the hierarchy in the council, because Melissa takes this home and uses it herself.
You have to get right into that double coat to get rid of all the dirt from it. You're just giving them a nice massage and making them as super clean.
I've never had a cow make a delighted noise at me. She's going, oh, yes.
I know how my hairdresser must feel now.
It's quite therapeutic.
It's very therapeutic. Don't you listen to them. You do what you like with your life. Honest to God, you're too good for him, I swear.
I think you should do the
tail. I think Susan should do the tail. Come on. You've been good so far.
Washing a cow's tail.
And then what you have to do is... There you go.
Oh, it's manky! It's manky!
That's why we left you to do the tail. You see how my hands are nice and clean?
Come and wash a cow, Susan, they say. It'll be fun, Susan. Is this the hairdryer? Righty-ho.
This Susan is nearly Highland Show ready.
It smells not bad.
It smells lovely compared to cow anyway, doesn't it? That's the cow's number one spot.
Oh, look, she's loving it. Just do your best. The people of Glasgow are proud of you no matter what happens.
After all that hard work, I've got a rare thirst on. So I'm getting out of the city and travelling to the nearby town of Cumbernauld to try and discover one of Scotland's best kept secrets. Launched in 1901 by A.G. Barr, Iron Brew has become synonymous with Scotland. This brightly coloured soft drink was an instant, if indescribable, hit, and today 20 cans are sold almost every second. I'm meeting commercial director Jonathan Kemp to tell me all about our other national drink.
Has it changed dramatically since those early days?
No. At the heart of Iron Brew is the 32 flavours that are blended together to make the taste that is sort of indescribable. It's just Iron Brew.
Once only sold in Scotland, Iron Brew is now sold in 70 countries worldwide. Cans were introduced in 1974. And of course, they still do taste tests.
That's my can.
That's your can.
Off the conveyor belt.
So, first thing is just to open it up.
Yes, I heard a...
So, make sure it's the right colour.
Does that look like the right colour for Iron Brew?
That's a sort of
if it doesn't
colour.
Turn your colour up on the telly, because it is.
OK, and then the most important way to taste test it.
Is there a way you do this, Jonathan? Do I...?
People do it different ways.
And am I allowed to swallow it, or should I relieve myself of it?
You're absolutely allowed to drink the full glass.
I would say that that was very definitely Iron Brew, Jonathan.
Now I'm an official taste tester, I'm on my way to a room that only a select few employees are allowed to visit, to meet Robin Barr, great-grandson of Iron Brew's founder.
I can't believe I'm about to find out the biggest secret in Scotland, right? It's just behind me in this building. And I'm sure he'll tell me that secret if I ask him nicely. Because why wouldn't he? I mean, you know, I'm the keeper of all the secrets of Scotland. Let's find out if he lets me know what it is. Woo!
It's a tall order, but someone has to do it.
Mr. Barr, thank you for allowing us into this secret room. Where are we?
We're in the Essence House, where the Iron Brew Essence is stored in the big vat behind you.
When I was growing up, we were always told that Iron Brew was from a secret recipe, and that's true, isn't it? That how many people know what the actual recipe is?
Two of us, myself and my daughter Julie.
Are there any other protocols or safety checks in place to make sure that that recipe is kept safe?
The only other arrangement is that my daughter Julie and I don't travel on the same plane.
I see, in case something happens.
In case it came down. Yes.
Oh, I see.
Just like the royal family. But I'm still hoping I might get one step closer to the secret recipe as I get the opportunity to smell the very essence of Iron Brew.
This is technically me sniffing the essence of life for many people. It's strong, obviously, yes, because it's the concentrated essence, yes, isn't it? But you can smell the Iron Brew.
Yes.
I'm trying to see if I can decipher the 32 ingredients. I can't whisper. So, the final thing to ask you, Mr. Barr, I don't know if you know this about me, but I used to be an intellectual property lawyer, so I'm a very, so trustworthy. I mean, you can probably find a more trustworthy person than me. Is it possible that you could just tell me a few of the ingredients?
No.
All I'm saying is I keep a lot of secrets for people. You're not gonna, there's nothing I can do to induce you to.
Not a lot, no.
I tried my best, I was there for hours. But he wasn't giving up. I'm really sorry, Scotland. Secret's still in there.
Coming up, I get up close to another side of the mighty Clyde.
Gentle trickling stream.
And discover how they rolled at the world's first infant school.
You could not bring a live baby crocodile into a school.
To discover the magic of Scotland for yourself with a two-night trip for two to the five-star Glenapp Castle in Ayrshire. Your stay includes breakfast, a dinner in one evening and a private sea safari too. To enter for a chance to win, text Scotland to 65555 or call 0902 055 0055 or post your name and phone number to Scotland PO Box 7557 Derby DE10NP. For rules, go to channel5.com/win. Good luck! I'm Susan Calman, and I'm on an adventure all over Scotland. I've been taking a fresh look at my hometown of Glasgow. The city is famous for its Clyde River, but 23 miles before it reaches Glasgow, it flows through another part of Scotland's industrial heritage, the cotton mills in New Lanark. This stunning beauty spot is a UNESCO World Heritage Site and served as the inspiration for a progressive thinking mill owner named Robert Owen. I'm meeting up with historian and guide Paige Hughes to find out more.
What's lovely, I think, about New Lanark is it kind of appears in front of you.
It does.
It's down this valley. It's a superb location, isn't it?
It is. It's absolutely beautiful. It's almost like a model village, and that's exactly what it was intended to be, out of all the debauchery and vulgarity of the city, this perfect little paradise.
So what was he trying to achieve here?
In his own words, he was trying to create a world without crime, without poverty, and where everyone could live in happiness and contentment with each other.
That sounds lovely.
That's so beautiful, isn't it? It's so nice.
I'd like that to happen now.
Owen took over the mill on the 1st of January 1800, and his ambitions for the welfare of his workers was groundbreaking. He also recognised looking after their children could be beneficial, which led him to build the world's first ever infant school, right here on the banks of the Clyde.
Oh, so this is it?
Yes. Welcome, this is one of Robert Owen's classrooms.
It's bigger than I thought it was going to be. It's really airy and spacious, isn't it?
Well, it is spacious, but it had to be, because at the height of the mills, there could have been up to 600 children educated in this building.
Well, that's quite a lot of
yeah,
kids.
It's quite a lot of kids.
Quite a lot of kids.
Owen was a very forward-thinking man, but some of his other methods might not be quite so popular today.
Robert Owen thought it was incredibly important that the children come face-to-face with something they never would have encountered, and that was a live baby crocodile brought into the classroom for the children to see.
Now, I'll tell you right now, I'm not an expert in educational law, but you could not do that these days. You could not bring a live baby crocodile into a school.
Owen's philosophy was hugely influential, and motivation rather than punishment was key to his principles, which he applied not just to children, but also to his mill workers.
This is our silent monitor, and the purpose of this was to instill discipline in the mills. Mm-hmm. So if you were doing great, you got white on the front, and if you were on the line for being sacked, really, then you got a black mark on the front. Now, this is quite funny, because we think this might be one of the origins of the phrase, I was black a front it.
Like,
that Ouija phrase.
Yes.
We were a bit embarrassed, a bit ashamed.
Oh, I'm black a front it by what just happened there. Absolutely. My dad's obsessed with this.
Definitely.
Mm-hmm. And it was a Christmas present. I'll be honest, I wanted a Scalectrics, but thanks for the lesson in social history, Dad. He's obsessed with these things.
The final leg of the journey takes me back to the Clyde, but in a form I've never seen before. Not far from the mills are the Coraline waterfalls. More water passes through these falls than any other in the UK. Though today finds them uncharacteristically calm. Wildlife expert Sven Rasmussen knows all about them.
This is almost a gentle trickling stream, but it is the Clyde, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. About 560 cubic metres of water go over every second at its highest.
I take it when there's a lot of water coming down, that must be quite a sight.
It's absolutely spectacular. You can hear the roar from a good few hundred metres away, and where we're stood now is completely underwater.
Well, in a good way, I'm glad that it hasn't been raining that much, otherwise we couldn't do this. That's extraordinary.
There's one last secret about this place, and the inspiration it gave to one of the greatest British artists of all time.
The falls themselves were a big inspiration for Turner. There's a painting from just about exactly where
we're...
Yeah, just
That's
about
amazing.
Exactly where we stood, yeah.
For me, I can't think of a more stunning place to end.
I've finished my journey here at the Clyde. It's a different Clyde to the one that's in the centre of Glasgow, but it's still the River Clyde that runs right the way through my hometown.
And what a journey it's been. I've done things I'll never forget. I've learned about the food.
Oh, it just keeps getting better.
The drink. And the colourful history of my hometown.
In a Glasgow stage, one of the world's greatest comedians was born.
And I like to think I've made some new friends.
You're too good for him, I swear. I mean, some people didn't give up their secrets to me, but you know what? That's OK. Sometimes it's nice to have a bit of mystery about a place.
Next time, I'm crossing the waters to the picturesque Isle of Skye.
Wow.
Getting my hands on some ancient secrets.
I'll be very, very careful.
Cheering on an adorable rare breed.
Come on, darling.
Trying out some new tricks.
And I've moved you out of the way and I'm off.
And making some pals along the way.
Would you like to share some sheep cake?
Yes.
And Susan's back next Friday night at 8.
Highwaymen, Poachers and Press Gang and Tony Robinson's History of Britain is new tomorrow at 8. And it's daylight robbery in New York, but we're covering the expenses. It's Holidaying with Jane McDonald and Friends, new after the break.